Hi, today I will be talking about the 10 things I set up every time I install Ubuntu on a PC or laptop. Most of these things are things I think should be pre-installed and set up by default in Ubuntu. So Canonical, if you are watching this, please add these to the default Ubuntu installation. Now, this is an almost stock installation of Ubuntu. The only things different from what you will get is this right here, Simple Screen Recorder, which is a screen recording application, which is the first thing I think should be pre-installed in Ubuntu, because everybody needs to record their screen at some point or another. If you don't want to install Simple Screen Recorder particularly because it doesn't work on WLAN and it depends on Qt, so it's a bit on the heavyweight side when you're installing from stock Ubuntu, you may be interested in Peak or Blue Recorder, both of which are available on FlatHub, which we will be getting onto shortly. So the next thing I install every time I set up a new Ubuntu system is GNOME Peaks. GNOME Peaks is an application to change those settings of the GNOME desktop environment which aren't accessible from the default settings application, like GTK themes, icon and cursor themes, hot corners, etc. I don't know why it isn't installed in Ubuntu, but it definitely should. It is very easy to install GNOME Peaks. You just need to go to the start menu, search for terminal and then type sudo, which is basically asking for administrator permissions, apt, which is the package manager, install gnome tweaks. I will be putting all the commands in the description as well. Enter. It will ask you for password. It won't show use the progress of typing in your password, so you just need to type it by yourself. Do you want to continue? Y for yes, and then enter. It will install pretty quickly because all the dependencies are installed by default in the stock Ubuntu. And then we wait for it to install. 12%, 18%. I will pause the recording here. And it has installed. It usually won't take as much time. It will be instantaneous on most PCs. I am recording on a virtual machine, that is why it takes a bit of time. And one neat thing is that it installs Chrome GNOME Shell as well, which is another thing which should be installed by default. I will be getting onto why. First, let's check GNOME Tweaks. So yeah, these are the settings which are not available in the default settings application, which should be. They aren't. One thing which I like to set up is the activities hot view, activities overview hot corner. So just click on it, and that is the best feature. You can just drag here and you will get all the applications here. For example, I have two windows open. I just take my mouse to the corner and I can select between the other ones, even if they are hidden behind or minimized or anything. See, I will minimize it, hot corner, it will be available open. The next thing I think should be pre-installed with Ubuntu is Chrome GNOME Shell. Chrome GNOME Shell is a software for installing and managing extensions or plugins for the GNOME desktop environment. I won't be installing Chrome GNOME Shell because it was a dependency of GNOME Tweaks, so it got installed as we installed GNOME Tweaks. If you want to install it separately, you can install it in the same way as we installed GNOME Tweaks. Instead of GNOME Tweaks, you just type Chrome GNOME Shell. The commands are in the description. The utility of installing Chrome GNOME Shell is that you can install extensions from the extensions.gnome.org website. Yes, so this is extensions.gnome.org, which is the official website for installing and removing GNOME extensions. GNOME is a desktop environment which comes pre-installed with Ubuntu, Fedora, etc. This is GNOME which we are using on Ubuntu right now. If you click here to install the browser extension, you will be able to install the browser extension for installing and removing GNOME extensions for Firefox. It also works with Chrome, Chrome GNOME Shell, and Chromium derivatives like Chromium and Brave and all the others. Once you install the extension, you just need to refresh the GNOME Shell page. Extensions page, and then you will be able to install and remove and manage the extensions which are installed. For example, we can see here However, there is an extension software available for managing them if you want to switch on or off or remove them. But for installing them, this is the main place for installing. And this should be enabled by default. Next up, we have image editing software. We don't have any on Ubuntu. For example, if I search Jim, not there. Color Paint, not there. So I think one should be installed by default. I suggest an application named Drawing, as it integrates well with the default Ubuntu experience. It can be installed by sudo apt install drawing and then your password. It's a very lightweight application because all the dependencies are in the default Ubuntu experience, so it is pretty easy to install. Again, it won't take as much time for you. I am on a virtual machine, so it will take some time. So I will pause the recording till it is installed. Drawing has been installed and we can open it by searching for it in the menu. If I can click that way. Yes, so this is the Drawing application, which is an alternative for MS Paint. And if you want it to behave like MS Paint, you can go to Preferences and then you can select Legacy. Legacy. So it will not like MS Paint, but at least like the Windows XP MS Paint. It will behave like that. And it has all the features which you would expect from an image editing program. It is a little intuitive because I don't know why, but yes. Once you get used to it, it is pretty easy to use. If you don't like the unintuitiveness of drawing, trust me, you will get used to it easily. But if you want something which behaves exactly like the MS Paint from Microsoft, you can choose to install Color Paint, which is KOLOUR, Color Paint, using the same command. The commands will be in the description. Next up, we have Flatpak. Flatpak is a package manager, just like apt, which is given by default on Ubuntu. But it has many more safety features. For example, all the applications are sandboxed. All Flatpaks are installed independently from the rest of the desktop. And Flatpaks run on all Linux distributions, be it Ubuntu, Debian, Fedora, Arch, etc. So that is why I think Flatpak should be installed. However, the chances of Flatpak getting pre-installed in Ubuntu are pretty slim, as Canonical is supporting their package manager Snap instead. I personally don't like Snaps, as they are closed source on the server side, which I think is against all the principles that Linux stands for. So that is why I think Flatpak is better. FlatHub is the most popular software repository for Flatpak, and I will be showing how to install it. First of all, we need to go to the terminal again. Sudo apt install Flatpak, give me a password. Yes. So it will install Flatpak. I should have installed another thing. I will install it now. The next thing we need to install is GNOME shell, the GNOME applications. This is the GNOME software. That is the app store for Ubuntu. I think it is very horrible, but it is the best we have. So GNOME software plugin Flatpak, and then yes. So this will enable the Flatpak applications to be accessible through the GNOME software. Once you have installed Flatpak, you need to go to your browser go to flathub.org. Flathub is, as I said, the largest software repository for Flatpak. And once you go to Flathub, you will get this quick setup guide here. There is one command which you need to copy. Ubuntu, this is Ubuntu. So you need to copy this command, which adds the Flathub
repository to Flatpak, and then you need to paste it. You need to right click and then select paste. Control plus V won't work on the terminal. And then enter a password. And then it has been added. And now you need to restart your computer so that the menu entries get synced. So I will do that and be right back. The machine has been restarted, so Flatpak should be good to go. One thing is that the Ubuntu software is actually Snap Store and not GNOME software. So it won't list the Snap, say Flatpak applications. You can search for software and then you will be able to install and or access the Flatpak applications. Chromium for example. Then as you can see, FlatHub. So the Flatpak applications are being listed here. It seems Snap applications are also being listed, so that is nice. Now you can, if you don't want this Ubuntu software application, which is basically a fork of GNOME software, you can just run the, on the terminal, you can run, let me show, terminal. So you need to run snap, remove snap store. So snap store is installed as a snap. And then you will be able to remove it like that. If you don't want this, and then you can manage all the softwares using the GNOME software tool. Next up, we have App Images, and rather App Image Launcher. If you don't know what App Images are, they're basically software packages which you can download from the software's website, and you can simply double click it to run it. And it will run automatically. You don't need to go to the terminal and install any software. You don't need to worry about dependencies. You can always go and install, download the latest version of the app image, and it will run automatically. So App Image Launcher is a software which will manage app images for you. For example, if you download an app image file and you download it on the desktop and then you run it. Usually it will just remain on the desktop and you need to manually move it to somewhere else, and then you need to create a desktop entry and all that if you want it in the start menu. App Image Launcher takes care of all that. You just need to double click a app image file. You will get this dialog. You can either run once, so you can run it directly, or you can integrate under, which means it will be moved to a separate folder on your home folder, and it will create a menu entry for it, which is nice. So yes, you can install App Image Launcher by github.com/theassassin/app-image-launcher. The link will be in the description. Then you need to click on Wiki, install on Ubuntu or Debian. Then you get these three commands. You just need to copy these commands without including the angle brackets. You just need to copy the command and then paste it in the terminal one by one. It will add a PPA repository on your computer, which will enable App Images to be App Image Launcher to be installed and updated easily along with the rest of the applications. Next up, we have Wine. Wine is a software for running Windows applications on Linux. I don't want Wine to be pre-installed by Ubuntu, and it probably won't ever be. But it is something which I install whenever I set up a new Ubuntu install. And Wine would run most normal applications. It won't run MS Office. It won't run the latest video games, AAA games. But if there is some software which isn't available for Linux, but some normal software, there is a pretty good chance it will run with Wine. So the steps for installing it is, again, go to a terminal, sudo apt install Wine, and then password again. Then you go yes, and then you will be able to install Wine, and then you will be able to run some of the Windows applications on Linux. is this website known as AppDB, available at appdb.winehq.org, which is run by WineHQ, the company which makes wine. And here you can see what applications run at what level. For example, if I search for, I think MS Office is here. Yes, MS Office installer runs at silver level, which means it has minor issues that don't affect typical usage. This particular entry, I can personally attest, is wrong. The installer may work for you. MS Office probably won't run, at least the latest versions of it. Office 2007 and 10 works perfectly, but the latest versions may not run. But yes, there are all the pages for all the separate software which are available for Windows, and how what is the level of compatibility with Wine. So here Wine is getting installed. It will take a lot of time, so I will not pause the recording. It will take a lot of time. But basically, when Wine is installed, you can right click on any exe file and then select Wine, and it will run. Most normal applications will run, but there will be a few which won't run. So you need to check on AppDB before you use Wine, and you should not depend on it. Next, we have Catfish. Catfish is a software for searching for files across your desktop, and Catfish is something I think should be installed in all Linux distributions by default. You can install it by going to the terminal. So you can install Catfish by doing sudo apt install Catfish. I am also going to install VLC Media Player, which is the next item on my list. So I'm going to install both of them together. Yes, and now we wait for it to download, install. Catfish and VLC have been installed, and we can run Catfish by searching for Catfish. And you can search anything. For example, if I search intro, which is the intro of this video, you'll be able to find it here. There are several options available here. There is a preferences, so you can select more options. And yes, you can search for files from the menu itself, for example intro, but my experience is that Catfish is just more faster and more efficient, and it lists all the files. I think there is a limit to the number of files which are listed by the menu. And yes, so Catfish is definitely one of the software I regularly use. The next software I had installed was VLC. So VLC has been installed. VLC is by far the best media player. It supports almost all file formats. So VLC has also been installed. So if you use VLC regularly, there you go. So I just found out that some tools in the drawing application are not enabled by default because they are either not reliable or not useful. The fill tool is in there. I am thinking that it is not as reliable. Hopefully it becomes more reliable as development goes on. Till then, thanks for watching this video, and I will see you next time.